I've been wanting to understand an algorithm called AlphaFold, which is about predicting the shape that proteins will fold into. And the reason I'm so interested in that algorithm is because before AlphaFold came along, the problem of protein folding was thought to be incredibly difficult to solve. I remember when I would go to quantum computing conferences, it would be cited as one of the main things that we were going to use quantum computers for. And then AI just managed to solve it without any special quantum computers or anything like that. So I wanted to understand, what is the magic that goes into this algorithm? And so finally, I took a week off to look at this algorithm in detail and to try and understand the basics of it, which I'm going to try and explain to you in this video, because I think it's super interesting. In fact, going into this, I thought that this algorithm would be rather similar to ChatGPT, because I knew that both of them use a thing called attention. Now, attention is basically all you need for ChatGPT, in that it was the new ingredient that went into the algorithm. On the other hand, AlphaFold does use attention, but it modifies it quite a lot to make it work for this problem. And I thought that was super interesting because I wanted to understand what it would take to solve difficult scientific problems using AI. But first, let me explain what the actual protein folding problem is. So you have a string of amino acids. That's what makes a protein. And each amino acid comes in 20 different varieties. So you can think of this string as almost a string of a 20-letter alphabet, right? And so in that way, it's not all that different from what ChatGPT is trying to do. That's dealing with like a string of words, and this is just a string of letters. But what we want to understand in the end is how this string is going to fold up. Because when proteins are put into a certain environment, for example, into water, they will fold in different ways, depending on the chemistry. Basically, some of the amino acids might be attracted to each other. Some of them may be hydrophilic or hydrophobic, determining whether they end up on the inside of the molecule or the outside. And there are other considerations like that that will ultimately determine the shape. So in a way, this is just a physical chemistry problem. But one of the things that protein folding algorithms often make use of is evolutionary history, because you can find a lot of information about a protein by looking at similar proteins in different species. So in the first step of the AlphaFold algorithm, you take this sequence of amino acids and you put it into a genetic database search and you look for similar proteins in different species. And then you put those together in what's called a multiple sequence alignment. So that MSA is basically just a matrix with one-hot encodings of all of the amino acids in each of those sequences. But the reason that this MSA is so important as an input is because you can learn a lot about the function of a protein by looking at which parts of the protein sequence, for example, have been conserved over different mutations and which parts have changed. And also, for example, which parts have co-evolved. For example, you might notice that position 2 and 4 have co-evolved together, which suggests that they're paired together. And that's important for the function of this protein, because if one of them were to randomly mutate, then the protein would no longer fold in the same way. The AlphaFold algorithm is going to take this MSA and it's going to update it as we go through the algorithm. But it's also going to have another input of sorts. So this is called the pair representation. And now traditionally, the pair representation is almost the output of a protein folding algorithm. So what it is you take every pair of amino acids in your target sequence and you think about their relationship together. So for example, the pair representation might just encode the distances between each of the amino acids, or maybe it also encodes the distances and the angles relative to each other of each of the amino acids. Like this in theory is enough to figure out the structure of this protein. But AlphaFold takes a slightly different approach where it also considers this as an input. And like the MSA, it's going to get updated as we go through the whole algorithm. Now, originally that input, of course, can't contain a lot of information. We don't start off knowing what the distances between the amino acids is. So it starts off with some placeholders, but we hope that as it goes through the algorithm, the model learns important relationships between each of the pairs. One important mechanism to make this happen is the MSA and the pair representation are going to update each other. So they have their own update steps, but they also have update steps that rely on each other, giving information between the two representations. So at the end of the first part of the algorithm, we're going to have a newly updated MSA and pair representation. But there is another part to the algorithm, which is the structure component. So it's going to take that information and turn it into that final prediction about the structure of the protein. But to do that, we're not going to actually use the entire MSA. We're just going to use the first line, because remember, the first line is the one that actually corresponds to our sequence in our species, whereas the other ones are other species. And so that first line is just like a 1D piece of information, which is why we kind of also need the pair representation, because while the MSA might have a lot of information about each of the amino acids inside of the sequence, we also want something to talk about the relationships between pairs. And that's going to be more encoded in the pair representation. So that's overall the rough picture of what the AlphaFold algorithm is trying to do. But now I want to talk about attention and how attention's being used. For this, I want to briefly explain what the attention mechanism is. But if you want to understand it in more detail, I highly recommend a video by 3Blue1Brown on this topic. It was amazing. But this is the gist of what attention is trying to do. So imagine you have like a large language model like ChatGPT, and it's trying to understand a piece of text. Of course, it needs to understand each of the words individually, but it also should try and add sort of contextual meaning to each of the words by looking at other parts of the passage. So for example, say I have a passage that has the word tube in it. Now, tube by itself kind of evokes a pipe of some sort. But if that passage had the word London in it somewhere earlier, then we would want that model to, instead of thinking of a pipe, think of something more like the London Underground. And so you can see how by paying attention to the word London, the meaning of tube got updated to mean something quite a lot richer and contextual. That's what we want to happen to all of the amino acids inside of the MSA. So for example, imagine that there is a spot in the MSA, let's say position 3, where it's always going to be amino acid A. So originally, this spot in the MSA just has the information in it, this amino acid is A. If we make that part of the MSA pay attention to that whole column, it would probably update to say something like, this amino acid is A, which is highly conserved in this position. That's a much richer understanding. And so this is called column attention, because we're going to pay attention down the columns of the MSA. And this is pretty much the standard attention mechanism. But you also want to pay attention across the rows. So what that represents is a single row is a single protein, right? And so row attention is when, for example, amino acid in position 4 pays attention to what amino acid in position 1 is doing. So in other words, it's looking at pairs of amino acids. But isn't that what the pair representation is about? And so that's why instead of just doing standard row attention, they add in a bias term that comes from the pair representation. So looking at what the pair representation says about that pair, and they add that into the standard row attention. So that's basically how the MSA is being updated. But now let's look at the pair representation. First, a bunch of information from the MSA is just going to be put straight into the pair representation. But then there are going to be some attention mechanisms, which are pretty similar to what happened for the MSA. However, it is going to be a little bit modified again. Now, this time, it's going to be modified to respect something called the triangle inequality. So here's what I mean. Suppose that you have some amino acids in positions A, B, and C, and you know the distances between them. But if you're going to do a standard attention mechanism on these pairs, then you're going to mess up the distances, because you would look at the distance between A and B separate from the distance between A and C and between B and C. And this could mean that you end up violating what's called the triangle inequality, which says that the distance between A and B is never greater than the distance between A and C and C and B. If you want to respect this piece of geometry, the idea is, instead of looking at all of the pairs separately, why don't we get the attention mechanism to pay attention to all pairs involving A and B? This is called triangular attention, and it's a pretty clever way to get the model to like learn consistent geometry by itself, which I think is a very clever idea. So that is the basic idea for how both the MSA and the pair representation get updated. And you do this whole thing a bunch of times, like lots and lots of times. And then at the end, you have your updated MSA and you have your updated pair representation. And the final step is that structure component. I won't go into that part too much because it is a little bit involved. But the basic idea is to treat each amino acid as if it's a triangle. And that's a pretty good assumption because the backbone of that amino acid is a bond with very rigid angles. And then you can treat the side chain as if it's just hanging off from that triangle. And there's one degree of freedom in terms of the angle there. But first, we'll just worry about the triangle. So to predict the structure of the protein, you need to get all of these triangles into the right positions. And one way to think about that is each triangle has a certain translation from the origin and a certain rotation. So you're trying to learn what the translations and rotations relative to all other triangles are. Now, again, you're going to use a similar attention mechanism, but again, you're going to need to modify it, and this time to make it aware of the invariances in geometry. So for example, this protein is invariant to overall translations and overall rotations. And so you need to bake that into the attention mechanism. Also, you need to make this attention mechanism work with transformations. So yeah, you need to modify it in a few ways. So that's the basics of the AlphaFold algorithm, how it goes from a sequence to a structure of a protein. If you want to understand the algorithm in more detail, then there's a bunch of great blog posts and talks that I watched that were really, really helpful to me. In particular, there was one by someone called Nazim Botar that was super useful. He was one of the main authors on a paper called OpenFold, which was a open source replication of AlphaFold. And next week, I'm going to try and replicate that paper. So I'll make a video about the progress there. Thanks for watching.